start coding, I'm going to redock my properties below the Solution Explorer just to get it out of the way. Because we're going to see this area change for writing our code. Now, the easiest way to write code for an object, if we want to write for the default event, in a button, the default event is a click event, that the user clicks on a button. And that's exactly what we want to do. So to write the code for that default event, the easiest thing to do is to simply double click on the button. And that will take us to the code editor in this central area. Now in the code editor, we have a bunch of statements at the top called directives. They start with the word using. And these are bringing in other classes for us to use in our project. These are all default. We don't necessarily need all these for our project, but we're going to leave them all there. And then we have this area called namespace. Now, namespace refers to our project in this case, which you'll notice and remember the 00 simple calculator was the name we gave it. That namespace you can think of as a container. And that container starts with a curly bracket and ends with a curly bracket. And note that these are on the same level, same indentation level. Then we have our class for our form. For now, all the code we write is going to be part of this Form1 class. It gives us a default method. Remember, methods are something that do something in a class or an object. So in this Form1 class, we have a method called public Form1. This is called a constructor. And it has a line of code in here saying initialize component. And what that does, it actually builds the window that we defined in the design mode. Now, speaking of the design mode, if you want to go back to that interface and change anything there, up here at the top of our editor window are some tabs, and we can click on the tab to go back to the design. Maybe we forgot to name something, or maybe we want to move something around. We can do that here. To go back to the code, we simply click the tab for the code. Now, when I double-clicked on that button, the plus button, the BTN add button, before it showed us the code, it created what we call a stub of a method, or a method stub. And that method stub starts with the word private. Notice this one started with public, and we'll talk about what those mean later. By the way, my focus here is not for you to understand the code. We're going to get into that. My focus here is for you to understand the process and the workflow. So we have this line of code, it says private void, but I want to focus in on this. BTN add click. That is the name of this method. And it created that name based on our object, which was BTN add, and the event, which was click. And I put an underscore between those to make one, basically a one-word name. It used an underscore since it can't use spaces. So BTN add underscore click is the name of that method. Now there's some things inside of parentheses after that. These are called parameters. By default, it gave us a parameter named sender, which reflects a type of object or a data type object. And another parameter called E, which reflects event arguments, or a type called event args. Actually, event args is a class. For now, we're going to ignore those between the parentheses, but also created a left bracket and a right curly bracket. This is the beginning and ending of that method. Just as up here on the public form, we had a beginning and we have an end of that method. And all the code we're going to write to do something when the user clicks this button has to occur between those two brackets. It's going to click between there. And the first line of code is I'm going to create some variables. I'm simply going to call A, B, and C since it's just a simple math problem. Normally my variables I want to make much more meaningful in their names. And in C#, we have to end our statements with semicolons. That just tells the editor and the compiler that's the end of the statement. I separate A, B, and C with commas. Now, a variable is simply a location in memory in our RAM that stores a value, and that value can change, which is why they call it a variable. Double is a numeric data type that can contain a decimal. We also have integer data types. We have float data types, which also contain a decimal. Integers are whole numbers. And there are others. We're primarily going to use integer and double, or actually int is how we're going to write it in code. So ints and doubles are what we're going to use primarily for our numeric calculations. I need to take the values of the two text boxes, that 12 and that 5 that we entered initially, or whatever the user puts in those two text boxes for first num and second num, and assign those values to A and B. So my next line of code is simply going to be A equals TXT. Now this thing that pops up here is called IntelliSense, and this is a great thing about Visual Studio. It's going to give you some ideas of what you should be typing here. In this case, it recognizes TXT and shows all of the controls that start with TXT. And I can simply double click on TXT first num. Now TXT first num is the control. What I want is the text property. And I'm getting a little red squiggly here, which means there's an error. And the error simply is that A is a double data type and the text property is a string data type. Strings are alphanumeric text. I cannot do math on alphanumeric text. So I need to convert this text value to a double. And I can use something called double.parse and put my text value or my string value inside a parentheses and end that with a semicolon. And now the little red squiggly goes away. Okay, I'm going to do the same thing here. B equals, I'm just going to type double.parse parentheses, and inside the parentheses I'm going to start txt, and I just choose second num. Now I need to conclude with a semicolon. Okay, so now, oops, and I still have red squiggly because right now that's the control. What I want is the property value. So I need to do txt second num dot text. My third line of code is we're going to take C and have C equal A plus B. We want to add these numbers together. And then I simply need to display that in that label. So we had our label LBL solution. I want to set the text property of that label to be C. But again, C is in double value, text is a string. I need to convert it to a string, and there's a method called toString. Methods always have parentheses after them. So when I see parentheses, I know that's a method. And what the toString method does, it converts another data type into a string. Just like the parse method, which is part of the double class, it has parentheses. And it has values inside the parentheses, which we call an argument. ToString does not take any arguments. Actually, it can. In this case, I don't need to provide any. But that then is going to put that value of C into our label. That is the extent of our code to make that button work. I'm going to go back to my design, and I'm going to double click on the subtract button. And now I get another stub for btn subtract underscore click. And what I'm going to do to make life simple, since almost the same thing as we did up here for the add, I'm going to select that code, copy it, Control-C, and paste it, Control-V. And the only thing I need to change here is the minus sign, the addition to a minus. So now I'm going to subtract B from A. So I'm going to show you another way to create the stub. I'm going to go to the Design tab. I'm going to select that multiplication button. But now in the properties, I'm going to go to the events. And I'm going to create a click event. So I'm going to find the click in my events. These are all the kinds of events that are associated with that button. You can see we have buttons do all kinds of things. And I simply give it the name that I want for that stub or for that method. And I could type in btn multiply underscore click. That'd be the default one. I'm just going to type in multiply. Let's just do multiply numbers. So I'm going to call my method multiply numbers. And when I press the Enter key, I now get that method. Let me dock my properties out of the way again. I get that method called multiply numbers. Notice it's got the same parameters. And it's ready to write my code. I'm simply going to paste the code I copied earlier. This time I'm going to change the plus sign to an asterisk. Shift 8. The asterisk is the multiplication operator, not an X. We use an asterisk. And so that method name of multiply numbers might be a little more meaningful than btn subtract underscore click, although that's also meaningful. It's probably a little easier to double click on the button. However, if you wanted to do an event other than click, you need to use this method of going to the events and choosing which event you want to handle. You can handle multiple events for each of these buttons. Okay, so I'm going to double click just on the divide button again. Dock my properties out of the way. Once again, I'm going to paste. I'm going to change the plus sign to a slash for division. Now with double precision, we can get a really long number. So if we're dividing 1 by 3, we're going to get 0.33333333333 and so forth. I want to curtail that a little bit. So I'm going to add a parameter, in this case, into the string method. And that parameter is going to be n2. I only want 2 decimal places. And I put that in quotes. So inside the parentheses, I put quote n2 quote. And that will give me 2 decimal places. Now, that's the extent of my code. Not so hard, is it? Like I said, I want you to understand the process right now. And you'll learn more about this code as we progress through the course. So now I need to test it. I'm going to click the Start button. That's going to compile it. There's my application. So let's go 12 minus 5 is 7. 12 plus 5 is 17. 12 times 5 is 16. And 12 divided by 5 is 2.40. I can change these values. So I'll go 10 and 4. Add those together is 14. Subtract 10 from 4 is 6. Multiply is 40. Divide is 2.50. Since I mentioned 1 divided by 3, we get 0.33. Everything seems to be working. I'm going to close my project from running. Back in the IDE, I'm going to go to the File menu and just make sure I choose Save All. Typically when you compile, it does run a Save All, but I like to be sure. And now we can end Visual Studio by clicking the exit button, or maybe I want to create another new project. I can go to File, New, and start a new project. Before we leave this, I'm going to go back to Windows Explorer and open up that simple calculator repository. I'm going to burrow down in to get to the bin folder and the debug folder, and now you're going to see my executable file. There's a couple of the files that it created, but the one I would want to distribute is the executable. In fact, if I just double click on it here, it's going to run. I could send that file to anybody with Windows, and they'll be able to run it. Now, when we get into more complex projects, there might be other files that need to be included. But for our simple projects right now, all we need to worry about, as far as distribution, is that executable file. The last thing here is we want to be able to compress all this into a zip folder so you can upload it into Canvas to be graded. I'm going to close my project, close the solution, and then we go back to Windows Explorer. I want to go to my repos folder where I have the project and find the project folder. Remember, this is the folder that contains the solution file. But I want to go one level back from that so that I have the folder that's containing that file and everything else. I'm going to right click, choose send to compressed zipped folder, and it creates a zip file with an icon of a folder and a zipper. And that then is the file you will upload into Canvas for grading.